Hello and good afternoon, everyone. Now we have got a panel discussion which will talk about leveraging digital transformation initiatives through technology-based solutions for citizen-centric approach. So for this session, I would like to welcome the moderator first, Mr. Vishal Goyal, who is the partner technology consulting for PwC. Welcome, Vishal. Vishal, you're on mute.
I'm sorry for that. So thank you, Fahim, for inviting me to moderate such an esteemed panel today.
Yeah. So with
on
this, I would like to
close to my heart.
Thank you. And the next speaker, I would like to welcome Mr. Noah Lyot. He is the Director of Financial Services, APJ, Tiger Graph. So Noah.
Hello, Fahim. Thank you very much. Very, very nice to be there today and speaking to such an audience and with such an esteemed panel. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I would like to welcome Mr. Amit Sharma, sir, who is the Administrative Secretary, Department of IT and CEO, Jakega, UT of Jammu and Kashmir. Welcome, sir.
Thank you. Thanks for organizing such a good conference and taking us on board, especially J&K as a host partner. So we are grateful to all of you and all my colleagues, seniors, who will be on board in this particular session. I welcome everybody on behalf of IT department.
We have kept you busy since 1 month and since morning also.
No problem. I think it is paying dividends. It's good to be here.
Yes, sir. Yeah. So with this, I would like to welcome Sarita Chauhan, ma'am, who is the Commissioner, Secretary, Labour and Employment Department, Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir. Welcome, ma'am.
Thank you for inviting me over for this discussion, which is so very relevant. To be with these very distinguished panel. Thank you.
And then we have got Dr. Ashish Kumar Srivastava, who is the Additional Secretary and Director, Department of Information Technology Development Agency, Government of Uttarakhand. Dr. Ashish Kumar Srivastava is like one of the renowned IAS officers who has done a lot of work in this sector. And he has been regular to our events also. Welcome, Dr. Ashish, sir.
Yeah, thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. And thank you for inviting me for a very good panel discussion on the very demanding topic of the time. So thank you. Thanks a lot.
And with this, I would like to welcome Dr. Shafkat Khan, who is the Official and Special Duty Department of Health and Medical Education, Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir. Welcome, Shafkat, sir.
Thank you, Fahim. It's wonderful to have such learned and great group of people here to interact with. We have Sarita Chauhan, ma'am. I am thankful that I'm part of this audience today. Thank you very much.
I would like to welcome Mr. Athar Amir Khan, who is the Commissioner, Srinagar Municipal Corporation and CEO, Srinagar Smart City Limited. Welcome, sir.
Thank you so much. It's a pleasure being here. Thank you so much.
So just for everyone information, our next conclave is with the Srinagar Smart City Department. And Athar sir will be the program mentor for that. We are doing a Smart Cities Conclave on 26th of November. Thank you, sir. Thank you for the opportunity, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. It's a pleasure. Absolutely a pleasure.
I'd like to welcome our last speaker, Avni Lavasa, ma'am, who is the Commissioner, Jammu Municipal Corporation. I think so. She's in a meeting. She might join later. So, Vishal, with this, I hand over this esteemed panel to you and I'll take a backstage. Over to you, Vishal.
Yeah, thank you so much, Fahim, for introducing the panel and reducing the load a bit from my side. So, So good afternoon, friends. I welcome you all to this discussion on leveraging digital transformation initiatives through technology-based solutions for citizen-centric approach. So friends, as you know, our nation has made large strides in delivery of citizen services. So in the beginning of the millennium, we had very less access to computers and the internet connectivity was a luxury. So the penetration of digital services in our country was very limited. But we have come a long way since then. And not only have we digitized so many hundreds of services, we have also created large digital public goods such as Aadhaar, UPI, Digital Locker. So not only in our country, but other countries are also looking for such products from India. So India is taking these platforms to other countries. So, for example, Aadhaar is being taken to so many other Asian and African countries for their national digital ID. So, friends, as you know, Aadhaar has made a lot of difference in how public services are delivered. I would just like to give a small example of SIM card issuance. So when Aadhaar was being used to issue SIM cards in India, it was a matter of only a few minutes that without any document, without much information to be provided, the SIM card was issued and activated. So it is not continued due to some regulatory issues, but that is the level of convenience that and efficiency that citizens of this country have experienced with the Aadhaar. And similarly with UPI and other things, the digital payments have come a long way. So the evidence of such large digital transformation is in the way we have handled COVID. So we could easily adapt to the challenges posed by the COVID, be it digital education, be it payments. So all those things we were able to address because of the large digital ecosystem that is available in the country. So I can go on and on, but it's not me who are you are here to listen to. So, but the eminent panel that we have. So I think Fahim has already introduced the panel to you. So I will go directly to the panel and request each one of them for their opening remarks so they can talk about any initiative that has been close to their heart, the context and the impact which has it has created on the citizens. So I would like to start with Mr. Amit Sharma. So over to you, sir.
Thank you, Vishal. So actually, this is a very, very relevant thing which we are talking about, the transformation and the interventions, latest interventions. So you very rightly pointed out Aadhaar has been a game changer. The way Aadhaar has actually moved things here and there and everything. Now, I think Aadhaar has redefined the way things were happening earlier. And it's a paradigm shift in the way things have happened. Like I can tell you, like in a lot of our projects, which we have actually done over in Jammu and Kashmir, especially if I talk about, say, domicile certificate, which is being issued, which is again a new thing. Or for that matter, even food civil supplies department, whatever services they are offering. So Aadhaar enablement has become a mandatory thing. One way or the other, like it's becoming easy for us also to actually link up people and create a common database. And in this particular thing, I would like to add on a couple of things. Like in future also, we want to create a uniform database. In fact, I was just listening to the discussion happening today and Director ACB, Mr. Anand Jain was giving a presentation and in the end he requested that please create a uniform database, which actually I told in the morning session only that that is on my anvil. Common database for all the departments. Say for that matter, whether it is social welfare or what you call health department or any particular labor employment, ma'am is also sitting. So any department, a beneficiary is actually trying to avail benefit of the services. So it is going to be a game changer in the sense like Aadhaar authentication becomes the basis. And why to forget DBT, direct benefit transfer, in which whether rural development, a lot of money is paid directly to the beneficiaries. But here the catch lies in actually doing deduplication of data exercise and creating a uniform database of all the beneficiaries in the UT, for example, for us. So some more interventions are required to make it more foolproof. And then another important exciting thing I want to touch upon here, which is very close to my heart, is the future lies in basically government process re-engineering. Because Vishal, you all are from corporate background. So we usually talk about BPR, business process re-engineering. Similar is the case of GPR. Like in the government departments, whatever services we are offering, what is happening is that in government departments, usually the services are being offered, but in a very traditional manner, the file goes up, down and all that. Although our very special intervention, or I would say a success story, is the successful implementation of e-office. Because we all have seen over the years in the civil secretariat how people used to clamor about their work and how work in one region used to suffer
when Darbar or say so-called capital used to move either to Jammu during winter months or Srinagar during summer months. And then lot of money was involved. It was not an easy thing. Crores of rupees, government exchequer was involved in actually provisioning of services like transportation and all that. And my quote often in most of the conferences used to be like, jokingly, we used to say if one truck goes into Chenab River flowing across, the whole department will vanish. So, you know, those all those anomalies or all those things have been very well addressed. Both secretariats are live now, working, and this thing has become a game changer. So similar kind of interventions are required, like deduplication of data and government process re-engineering, that is cutting down the steps in the government. Like there are certain steps in functioning of each kind of thing in every department, which requires to be visited. And when we do this process re-engineering, we will cut down the steps, which are unnecessary steps. File moving up, file coming down, and those things. This is very much required in order to actually save time, economies of scale, economies of resources, and at the same time, optimal utilization and getting results in a time-bound manner. So GPR is a very, very common thing, and I'm sure with the intervention of corporate, many UTs and states have already gone for GPR in many departments. So that is on my anvil. And then couple of more things I have in mind, like provisioning of services to the last mile user. That is at the doorstep. Like you guys must be aware that a Khidmat Center model started in Jammu and Kashmir some few years back. It was a good noble initiative, like still they are in some form, but then CSE, it is basically Common Service Center. So CSE model. So in that, like I just had a word with CMD of CSE SPV, and we are planning to enter into an MOU with them to take it in a big way. Like we want to actually go in for creation of this kind of model in which VLEs will visit the homes of the people, and with very simple interventions like a mobile call, a call from a phone call, the person will give the details and all that, and VLE will actually generate the certificate or the document required for that service, required for that person, and deliver it at the doorstep. And I was told by CMD that Delhi government has already implemented that. In a way. So this is something which is going to be the future. Like people feel sometimes harassed going to government offices again and again, visiting for their work. Although we are taking e-office outside big way, as I talked in the morning also, almost I have got a list of more than around 250 field offices, HOD offices, which we have brought online on e-office platform. Now it is for them to actually take a lead and start working on it. We have done all kinds of hand-holding, capacity building, even demo files have been, dummy files have moved. So whatever best my teams could do, Jakega and ITD guys, they are doing the best possible job in a very, I would say, we are trying to implement reforms under the aegis of our worthy Chief Secretary, sir. He is very particular about the timelines. So this way we have taken land records to a new level, like all 20 district land records have been finally computerized. And I mean to say, we are taking digitization of data has happened. And any day we will have its formal inauguration. And CCTNS, couple of days back only, you must have seen all police data, important critical data has been brought online. That has been brought by our Honorable LG, sir, along with Chief Secretary, sir. So a lot of reforms are going, and it's an irrevocable, irreversible process the way we are moving. So a lot of success stories to share. But again, I think I must respect the time, and I have a lot of people, my seniors sitting here, would love to listen them today. And wherever, if chance comes again, I would again intervene and share my ideas.
So thank you so much, sir, for your insightful discussions. And you brought in a lot of subjects, DBT, doorstep, e-office. I've been fortunate enough to be part of all these initiatives in some shape or form. So we'll be happy to catch up with you after the conference. And may I now invite Ms. Sarita Chauhan, ma'am, to share her opening remarks.
Yeah, good afternoon, all of you again. So it was nice to listen to Amit also. He's the IT secretary. We have had a good working experience together earlier also. And with his inclination in the, you know, IT areas and how to bring about services, he's been personally a very, you know, technology kind of a person, and I've known him therefore as a colleague in the government. And so he would keep an eye on the larger issues, the larger interdepartmental cooperations that are required at his level in the IT department while he's there. So I have had an opportunity of working in a number of departments, and continuing from where Amit left, in fact, the government in Jammu and Kashmir has laid a special emphasis on trying to take all the service delivery on through e-solutions, right? And if you take an example of, say, school education department, if the schools who have to open schools or private schools or any other kind of permissions that are required, everything is now through, you know, technology, through these platforms, it is provided. Similarly, even in the housing and urban development department, several new apps were launched. And when I talk of my own department, in the labor and employment department, while the major role of the department is a regulatory department, which means that it regulates the establishment and functioning of the private or other organizations in a manner that they respect the labor laws, and then that the interests of the laborers is protected. They are also, we're able to have a conducive environment. So if you see, we have an interaction with the largely private sector, you know, establishments, with the objective of also protecting the interests of the a very large force of workers which works with these industries. So it becomes very important that the department accepts these, and in the true sense of providing service easily to all these establishments, we have in the department made at least 15 services online, which means mostly those are those pertaining to the registrations, those pertaining to the renewals under several acts. There is a huge amount of, you know, change going around in the labor laws and labor acts also, with the objective of trying to see that they are made more easy. So when I say that, you can realize as of now, the number of acts and which have to be, you know, taken into consideration when it comes to implementing the labor laws, etc., were about 38 to 40. Thankfully, the government of India has now, you know, brought them together or redesigned the entire thing and placed them in four different codes, which are called labor codes. So this is just to mention the extent of the whole issue. Now, we have, like, somebody wants to establish shops, then there are renewals, all these licenses are required, you know. Then you have under the Contract Labor Act, you have registration and renewals. Then there are Employment Contract Labor. Then there are Interstate Migrant Workers Act. There also you require registration and renewal. The objective, the idea being to see that whatever number of workers is working with them, the establishment is brought within the regulatory framework to say, to protect the interests of the workers. So we have made a big leap there in the sense that, you know, the interface with the physical interface has been cut out. And with this, we find that there is a general, what we say, the real outcome of the government service, in the sense that there is a lot of satisfaction. But at the same time, the laborers and the workers that we have been able to reach out to is tremendous. And we are able to see that the several other business reforms which were required, the state itself, you know, that again, with the initiative of the government of India, the whole country started with what is called the business reforms, bringing about reform business action plans we had. And each department was given a lot of areas where they would like to reduce the compliances. Compliances can only be reduced provided we have these IT interventions. And with this interventions, we have been able to see that the compliance burden is reduced. What I'm talking about is basically giving a environment of ease of doing business, which has been a priority of the government. And the JNK state as a whole, UT as a whole is leading in the country. And within the UT, I can say that the Labor and Employment Department again has been in the forefront of implementing these ease of doing business regulations. All these translates to better efficiency, more production, etc., and a satisfied clientele, of course. A good example of, Amit referred to also the Common Service Center. In the Common Service Centers, with the help of the Common Service Center, we are at present doing what is called the registration of the unorganized workers. Last year in 2020, we saw the kind of plight that our workers were also put to, besides, of course, the whole world. But there was no number of such people. There was not a definite number that we knew of so that we could reach out to them. So whatever was done was by, you know, taking proactive actions during the time of the crisis. So you can very well imagine. So managing the crisis situation, again, technology is the only hope. And we are, therefore, through the e-Shram portal, which the government has launched, we are now registering and intend to register about 38 lakh unorganized workers in JNK alone. The whole country, the target is around 38 crores. So these are again steps which are taken in the welfare of the section of the society which we can say does not have any voice. Besides these, there are general issues, of course, regarding the implementation, which was referred to as the government process re-engineering. I would say the process re-engineering also requires a re-engineering of the mindsets in the sense that any digital space would also require a change in the physical space. You know, we can in the government begin with, say, having a cell which is entirely oriented in its, if not the entire setup immediately, but definitely that is what one is looking at. And with the kind of interest we have amongst the officers across the seniority levels, we are all rearing to see that we provide the best service with the best outcomes to the people and take the governance and delivery of government services to the doorstep, which has been, of course, the objective as always. But with technology, this can be done. And without it, it is absolutely unthinkable. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. May I now invite Dr. Ashish Kumar Srivastava for his opening remarks.
The digital transformation, actually the technology, the use of technology in government, I generally divide that into two important, you can say the era is a pre-COVID and the post-COVID era. So the use of technology in a pre-COVID era was like there was a status quoist mindset that how to use it, when to use it. So what will happen? And most of the time, like the government departments were reluctant to use some of the technological interventions. In a post-COVID era now, everybody is running behind the IT agencies of the government that my department should be done on the priority with the e-services and our services should be online. So all those type of rush is now there. So now I hope that all IT departments and the nodal agency of IT in the state governments must be flooded with the work. The Uttarakhand is also not a different story. So from morning to evening, the entire team is working. Now the government is also willing to invest more in the IT infrastructure. You can say the IT journey in the Uttarakhand actually started in 2005-2006 when we conceptualized the e-district project. Uttarakhand was one of the front runner in the e-district project implementation, and after that many of the states actually followed it. Now, as of now, the government has recognized 256 services under the Right to Services Act, which should be implemented, and the government and the public should be delivered the services at the doorstep. So now all those things are actually implemented in Uttarakhand, and now from starting from the cabinet meetings, now the Uttarakhand has all e-cabinet meetings. Now all meetings are get away with the papers. So from there, now we are working on digitizing the block level offices from the block level offices to the Honorable Chief Minister office. So the process is right now undergoing. 9th November is our State Foundation Day. And earlier we had 32 e-district services. Now we have 75 e-district services, which will be inaugurated on 9th of the November. So, and we have a target by the end of this year, all 256 services should be online. And by the end of this financial year, all government offices should be paperless. So the government is working on this, and what I want to say regarding the my experience with the technology and what interventions my team has done earlier is, like, when I was in the Development Authority, most of you must be knowing the Mussoorie Dehradun Development Authority. Everybody come to Mussoorie for the trainings. So that time, actually, we started the fastest building plan approval system, and which is actually the faceless as well as the contactless paperless system. So this is as fast as like one and a half hour it takes, actually one hour 30 minute time to approve a map. So that is actually the intervention we did for ease of doing business. And in EODB, actually, Uttarakhand is one of the front running states right now. It has improved its ranking tremendously. And that was the thing. What I feel that when you are doing certain thing online or the digitization and the digital transformation, then it is very important to have timelines also, because most of the time it happens that we do the services online, and then what happens that earlier we were dumping the files manually, now the files are dumped in the system. So that how this will be actually taken away is very important. And that's why we started doing this thing like a color coding of the files. Whatever files are coming in the system, all are color coded, because most of the time it happens that you have an escalation matrix. So the escalation matrix is actually good for the public grievance redressal system, where if the person who is responsible is not able to redress the grievances, then it is actually escalated to the one higher level, and then it is actually resolved. So that system is different. But once you come in a government regular working, then the function which has been assigned to a particular person has to be done by that person. Like, it cannot be escalated to the higher authority the higher authority will perform the function of the lower authority. So that is the thing where we started this model, that the color coding of the system. And most of the time, all the files are actually having the three colors, red, yellow, and green. So if suppose if any staff is having 5 days time to dispose a file, so for 4 days it is red, then the last fifth day it is yellow. Yellow is an alarm that you should clear it. And if you are not able to clear, then that file will be actually shown to the desktop of the dashboard of the higher authority, the highest authority. So like, my chief secretary can view the performance of a grassroots functionary in a block or a tehsil like Lekhpal or the village development officer. Everything can be seen from Dehradun only. So and it has a performance matrix also, like how the department is performing, how the employee within the department is performing. So that type of system, the check and balance, has been developed. And the e-services are basically very important. If you see, whether it is Uttarakhand or the Himachal or J&K or all the hilly states, where accessibility is a big issue. So government cannot reach to each and every person because the topographical challenges are too much. So the technology is basically the answer for it, how to reach to each and every individual. So that is very important. And like, in our e-services, what we are going to start on the 9th of November that will have actually the console for the citizen also. Like most of the time it happens that for if you want a service, then you have to take report from a grassroots functionary like Lekhpal. For other service, you have to again go to Lekhpal for taking the same report. So that we are taken away. Now every citizen is given a DigiLocker so that all the reports are kept there, and there is a validity for every document. The same document can be used repetitively. So that on the one hand, actually it has reduced the burden of the citizen for moving here and there, and on the other hand, it has actually improved the performance of the grassroots functionary. Sometimes it happens that we always say that they don't perform, but most of the time we generally forget how much work pressure they have. So that is the work we want to do, and also very important, one thing is very important, that we have to change our rules, regulations to enable the technology to perform. So all those things are actually the government is working, and I hope that the data which government is having, and this is a time when the government should also think about the data-driven governance rather than only taking decisions based on the popular demand. So thank you. This is from my side.
So very rightly said, sir. So over to Mr. Athar Amir Khan for his opening remarks.
Thank you so much, and good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon, ma'am and sir. We have respected seniors, and it was wonderful to listen to all of you. As far as Srinagar city is concerned, both in terms of the mandate that we have in Srinagar Municipal Corporation and Srinagar Smart City, there are in fact significant IT interventions that we are in process of implementation. One of the major projects that we have is our integrated command and control center that we are developing for the city. That's going to be an umbrella structure for IT infrastructure in the city. So this integrated command and control center, it's coming up at a place called HMT in Srinagar, which is going to have its own network operations center, huge command center, a data center, a communication center, and this is one place which is going to control and coordinate all the IT interventions, whether they are citizen services, whether they are emergency services, whether that is traffic management or even the policing services. So this integrated command and control center, right now it is in the go live stage. It is live, and we are hopeful that by the mid of next month, the physical infrastructure and the setup will also be ready. So that is one of the major projects that we are working on. Besides that, when it comes to Srinagar city, because of many a times there are problems with internet, and one major issue that we face is the connectivity part. For example, we have right now, say, we're installing also this integrated intelligent traffic management system with centrally controlled traffic lights at all the junctions. Now, all these junctions are connected to the center servers through our GSM or other SIM cards. And if the internet goes down, the entire system gets shut down. That's why there's one more important project that we are under the process of implementation. We call it Srinagar Data Network, which is around 175 kilometers of fiber network, which is being set up in the Srinagar city, which will connect all our major nodes, whether they are the junctions, whether they are the variable messaging displays, whether they are the security cameras. So irrespective of what the situation of internet is, our services in the city will not suffer. So that's kind of a highway, the information technology highway that we are creating for the city. So with ICCC and Srinagar Data Network, the infrastructure for the service delivery is going to be quite strong. Besides that, what we've also done is that our integrated command and control center, we're also integrating it with the decision support system of Disaster Management Authority, so that whether it is the flood management, whether it is the management during the winter season, whether it is management in the earthquakes, so the response and as well as the management of the disasters can be done quite fast. In fact, the intention is that initially our integrated command and control center will also work as a state emergency operations center for a while, till a full-fledged one is coming up. Besides that, we are also actively working on the traffic management on the city. Some years back, there were some traffic lights placed and at certain junctions, but the entire system did not work. Now we have phased it in two parts. One is we call it adaptive traffic control system, which is almost around 95% at the stage of completion. So all our junctions, they're having the traffic lights with adaptive cameras so that they can do the queue detection as well. And we're hopeful again that by the mid of next month, we'll commission that entire ETCS project. And in the second phase, we're also installing our PTZ, those pan tilt cameras, as well as the automatic number plate recognition system for the city. So that whenever any vehicle is moving around the city, if there's a violation of the traffic rules, if there's a violation of red light, there can be quick detection of the numbers. And our traffic police can send challans directly to their homes or to their accounts. So that entire system is also being put in place. We have already completed our control system, which is control center, which is also placed at the traffic police headquarters. Besides that, there's one more very interesting project that we have taken up. It's called the GIS mapping of the city. And in under this project, what we are doing is that we are mapping each and every household, each and every establishment, every premise, every office in the city. So every such premise will have a digital QR code based address, and the GIS instance of that address will be in our database. So this is going to completely change the way we do service delivery on ground. So whether it is snow clearance, whether it is our sanitation, whether it's our electricity or our water supply, we'll be able to monitor and manage those services in a far better way. Same also goes for our emergency services. For example, if there's a fire incident in a place X, the moment there's an incident created from that place, our system quickly knows the exact location of that place, and the immediate first responders, the nearest police station, nearest fire service, emergency services center, or the nearest hospital, that they could be immediately alerted, so that the response time could go down. And we were doing certain simulations on the basis of this, and in certain services and certain responses where it's taking time as long as 5 hours or 4 hours, we can reduce that response time to as low as 7 minutes. So that's going forward what we are trying to do. Besides that, as far as the municipal corporations is concerned, we offer around 35-40 odd services to the city, and in the past few months we have digitized almost all of these services. So whatever municipal corporation services are offered, they are available to people online. The one of the most important service that we have is the building permissions, which traditionally has been one of the sore points as far as municipal services are concerned. People that we apply for building permissions, we don't get them on time. Files get stuck at different levels. Some NOCs are pending with different departments. So we have digitized that entire building permission system. It's available to people online. The certificates also are issued online. We don't move the files physically now. Similarly, for the registrations, because we do birth and death registrations and issue and non-availability certificates and etc. So that's again one of the major services. In fact, every month more than 2,000 of such, every week more than 2,000 applications only of the birth and death registrations we receive. So that entire system is also digitized. Similarly, whether it's booking our community halls, whether it's our sanitation services, bin services, compost services, all of those services are now available for the citizens of Srinagar online. In fact, there is at present, whether it is RTI, you can file an RTI online with us, whether it's a regular application, that also you can do online with us. And in fact, that's one important thing that we have been able to do. Besides that, we are also working on one important project. We call it again the progress monitoring system, but it's more in terms of the governance framework, in which we are trying to create a system in which people in their respective wards can see what's happening in their wards, how many works are going on, what is the status and progress of these works, and they can also give a feedback about those works, whether the progress which is being shown on the platform is right or not. And in the going forward with some of the organizations, including Praja Foundation, we are working on creating a system in which the bottom-up planning could be done. Maybe the people in the ward themselves do an online poll and survey about what are the major works that should be taken up by the municipal corporation. So that was from the services point of view. And towards the end, there's one very important application that we have developed. It's called My Srinagar app. Now this is in fact one of, again, very flagship projects. The reason is that we wanted this My Srinagar app to be kind of a public interface of what municipal corporation or what the city is. So at present, we have different departments, whether it is electricity, whether it's municipal corporation, whether it is, say, social welfare, whether it is water supply. Different departments are providing services to people. Most of these are online, of course. But if a citizen has to say avail a service from one department, he has to actually look for it on online. He has to look for it on their website or portal. With this My Srinagar app, we wanted to create this as a one-stop app. So this is one stop. So citizen need not go anywhere. This just one app should be sufficient for him. So he can avail services of all the departments, whether that's of the municipal corporation or whether that's of any other line department. So this app is right now, it's both live on the iOS as well as on Android. And it has been categorized among the one of the best apps recently. So that's something we are actually trying to further improvise on it, and with the ICCC integrated command and control center at its Equinox platform in the background. So this app is going to be a very powerful tool for us to the service delivery. In fact, we have also tried to include certain components for the tourists as well, so that if tourists come to Srinagar city, they can find out, know about the destinations here, destinations around the place. There's a search engine integrated with it. They can do online bookings, both for the government, JKTDC properties, as well as the private properties, as well as they know about the weather and all other information that we have tried to integrate. So going forward, my sense is that with our new projects, including ICCC and Srinagar data network and digitization of services, and with My Srinagar app as a front end, as a citizen interface, we should be doing a significant improvisation in the service delivery and in terms of how people see the city and how city serves its people. Thank you.
So thank you so much, sir. I think, in fact, I'm looking forward to visit Srinagar to see the impact on ground and avail these services. So over to Dr. Shafkat Khan now, and then for his opening remarks.
Hi, good afternoon, everyone. I am happy to be here with all of you. And my topic today would be the e-health initiatives which we have taken in JNK. And as you know, post-COVID, we have come to understand that the e-factor can play a very huge role in delivery of good quality healthcare to people and improve the accessibility of and the interface between the patients and the people who deliver it. You know, the Even app, which has been such a success, you know, huge success across the country. And as you all know, we have crossed the 1 billion mark. And I think I should give full credit to the app itself and the people who have, number one, made this app, and number two, those who have used it on the ground and made it possible. And you very well understand that when there's an initiative, it has to be very user-friendly. And COVID, the login in of a person for vaccination and his first dose and his time for the probable second dose, all comes on the Even app. And, it's a seamless, system of entry into the vaccination, COVID vaccination system, and getting vaccinated. Nevertheless, because of the COVID itself, the problem of people not being having access to the hospitals physically, e-Sanjeevani has hit such a great, height in this entire process. And as you know, we today even have a lot of, it was estimated last month that around 400 hits come on e-Sanjeevani from JNK every day. And it is quite a huge success across the country as well. And we have been smartly able to, involve the state doctors, paramedics into the entire process. The National Health Mission has incorporated the access of the ASHA worker to these apps. ASHA workers are being provided smartphones, tablets at the lower level, at the highly inaccessible areas and terrains. And these people have been able to accumulate data, and data, as all of you know, is a very important part in any digital process. We anticipate that if we are able to capture the data from the ground, we will be able to use this data efficiently to plan our health services further. And as you all know, Ayushman Bharat has been a huge success, and the launching of the National Digital Health Mission, which will be envisaged, is going to take off very soon in this UT of J&K also, is going to, you know, focus on an ecosystem where the person who is digitized, his entire medical record will go onto a repository, which will be a national repository later. In that national repository, if you walk into any hospital across the country, your health history, your data will be available there. And your status, even your Ayushman Bharat, the universal healthcare scheme, which I want to also inform some of you who do not know, who are in the panel, that we have a universal healthcare scheme unique to the state, unique to the UT of J&K, wherein a family is insured for 5 lakhs, irrespective of the number of people in the family, irrespective of the age, you know, of the family members. So we have this universal health scheme which covers every citizen of the UT of J&K, and it was launched and by the Honorable Prime Minister. And we are so lucky to have, you know, achieved around 40% of the registrations already. And a Gaon Gaon scheme is going to be launched very soon to, you know, take all the persons who are eligible. In fact, all of them who have not yet been, you know, registered into the fold of that universal healthcare scheme. And in my own opinion, that health insurance is the key word. You know, it is the success story. You know, Ayushman Bharat first and the universal healthcare scheme, it is true success in all the fronts. We have people who now come to us and say that they went to one of the expensive hospitals in Delhi and got their treatment free of cost. And somebody got his heart valve replaced, somebody got hip joints placed, and whatnot. But my point is that we have not been able, you know, in the past years to do much into it. The focus has now started, and I very honestly tell you that the focus is very hard to take the e-office to our e-hospitals now. E-office, as our IT secretary has said, that e-office has become a huge success, and the transformation from the normal file, physical file, to the e-office is a huge success. Now, we have recently started doing e-hospitals. We have tied up with our own agencies, the government IT department, the NIC, for having this e-hospital software in all our hospitals. At whatever level, we will start from the district, sub-district hospitals, then go to the PSCs. We assure that we are looking towards smart hospitals, where a person would enter a hospital, his name, his unique ID would tell us everything about him, about his disease, about his condition right now, what was his history, not by every time coming and repeating that process. But nevertheless, we have the integrated disease surveillance program, which integrates all kinds of communicable diseases, and the NCD, the National Non-Communicable Diseases. Non-communicable is the hypertension and diabetes, thyroid, and other diseases. And a huge focus is laid on to diseases which are associated with health hazards, which are associated with occupational hazards, which are preventable, very preventable diseases. But as I said, data is going to be the key word in whatever we do. If we want a good system of digitalization of our records, we'll have to have good data on the ground, and good data will only we be there when we have committed people going on ground and gathering that data. I understand that we have in the smart city project of both the cities of Srinagar and Jammu, there are smart hospitals, as Mr. Athar has already pointed out, that the smart city envisages to cover the city hospitals in the smart city fold, and we'll have later the peripheral and the bigger associated hospitals and the peripheral setup, you know, connected as well. I fully understand that the digitization of healthcare is a need which you know has come to fore because of probably through COVID. We were going slow earlier. Now the speed we have taken on the digital side of life is very fast, and we will have to catch up. You know, it is an eye opener. In fact, COVID, that we'll have to invest more energy, time, finances into getting systems digitized and you know, user friendly. Also, as one of the panelists said, there is an app. You know, so I think in health also we are trying to have these kinds of apps where you can find out immediately which hospitals are located. You'll be glad to know that we, after a gap of almost 7 to 8 years, we last year were able to have the 102-108 ambulance system in place. You know, if you dial 102, you will get a ambulance, basic life support ambulance. And if you want a critical or advanced life support ambulance, you have to dial 108. And now we have also come up with a 104 line where you will just be able to talk to a doctor. You know, I at the closure would want to specify that mental health will be a huge challenge in the coming years. You know, COVID has led us to a lot of challenges in the mental health side. And I have a sure belief that we'll have to invest a lot of our time and research into thinking what dent it has caused to our society, to our people, to our children, to the society at large. And the health experts at all levels in our country will have to work on systems which will, you know, improve, help up people to cope up with these problems and help them get over this. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Khan. So may I now invite Mr. Noah Lior to share his views on digital transformation.
Yes, thank you very much. And thank you to the panel for sharing their very deep experience in those different aspects. So first, let me introduce who is TigerGraph and what do we do and why maybe we haven't touched as deep in, you know, governmental project and probably our technology is not used currently at scale for citizen and, you know, life enhancement, but oh, it will actually help you in the future. And that's a guarantee. So we are the leading provider of graph analytics, and we are also the first and only distributed native graph database in the industry for advanced analytics and machine learning and connected data. I'll explain what that means in more, you know, practical ways in a few minutes. Now, this technology currently is used in many, many industries. We use it for anti-money laundering. It's currently used for entity resolution, customer 360. It's used for recommendation, knowledge graphs, cybersecurity, supply chain, IoT, network analysis, and so on and so on. I could keep on going. So it's used across many, many different industries vertical, including governmental. And we have more than 1,200 customers worldwide that, you know, including 8 of the top 10 global banks. I can't speak about this because that's my specialty, but I'll go into also governmental application in a few seconds. So I'll explain what the paradigm change is about. We have, since the 18th century, something called graph theory, which is an entire field of mathematics, which is quite useful for application in many, many, many problems and range of especially optimization and research and things like that. Now, while we have had that corpus of theory for a very long time, we have only recently caught up in terms of technology. And actually, it's so recently that, as I mentioned, we are the first to be able to do it at scale on the market. And we have been doing this since 2017 publicly. We started building in 2012. So this has been a long journey coming. Now, how is it? How is it important to citizen and how is it important to government? And what do I mean by that? Well, technology, as we all know, the value of technology is blurring silos, is actually going transversal into silos and actually bringing better experience to people. That's what technology does. It breaks down those walls and those walls of information where the information actually does not pass from one silo to another and actually bring you a more full of view of whatever problematic or whatever objective you have, whether you are an organization or whether you are a governmental agency. Now, I'll give you a very simple example. For example, we are working with the Australian Taxation Office, and the Australian Taxation Office use our technology to identify complex fraud which are hidden deep into the data and actually remove that burden from the citizen in also the repatriation of funds that has been evaded. This is just an example of a governmental engagement that we have, but we have actually many other use cases that could be raised on, and this technology could actually enhance. Now, this is a revolution, and when I say that, it's not just my words; it's Gartner that says that. Gartner actually said that by 2025, 80% of the entire analytic world will be done on graph system. They have actually said a few weeks ago, 50% of the discussion regarding analytics now is about graph databases and graph systems. So this is really a game changer. And to give you an idea of a game changer, it's literally the same game changer as when you had the big data revolution and the Hadoop system came out, and suddenly you could process huge amount of data and you can digital everything. This is also a game changer that is similar to the first, you know, deep neural networks being able to run in production, and, you know, deep convolutional, for example, for image recognition. This is the impact we're talking about in terms of this change in technology. So let's go into practicalities. How can it be used to actually enhance citizen life, right? Well, we were talking, for example, we can talk about upskilling. You could use graph systems and graph database to understand the job market, where the job market will evolve in the future, what will be the skill set that will be needed to meet that job market in the future, and how to basically upskill the citizens. So that would be an example. It can be used in the domain of identity with digitalization and digital identity. You could actually use that technology to have, for example, a complete and more holistic view of a citizen as a person, in terms of administrative task and administrative documentation, but also in terms of his journey in life. It can be used, of course, if I speak about journey in life, in healthcare. So for example, we have a lot of our clients that are actually healthcare insurance provider, very large one, that use it to actually detect both healthcare fraud, but also recommend next steps, but also to provide preventive care. And it could also be used, for example, we were talking about COVID, in contact tracing or things like that. This technology fits perfectly well for that. Where can it be also be used? Well, agriculture. You can do resource optimization in terms of agricultural policy, and you would be able to find out where exactly should resources be spent to optimize your agricultural policy. You could use it in energy. We have clients using it currently in their grid optimization, including, for example, China State Grid. So it is actually used there to optimize, their grid distribution system and their smart grid application. We can be used for, we were talking about, for example, city and, for example, smart city. It can be used for traffic optimization. It can be used for monitoring and tracing different, vehicles and flow of people throughout the day and in the cyclicity of a normal work day in a city. It can be used, of course, for telecommunication, assurance networks, identify root cause analysis in case of network failure. It can be used to actually find alternative network paths to maintain services to the citizen. It is also very much used, as I was mentioning, in banking and financial regulation, because we can trace the flow of product. And this is where graph is so strong. Graph can be used to represent physical system, geographical system, but also relationship between people and symbolic system. So it really applies across the entire scope of representation, and it allows you to have more powerful analytics on those representation. So practically, well, this can impact the citizens through governmental initiative and partnership with technological companies such as ourselves. And it also will offer eventually a more appreciable experience for the citizen, as it will be a seamless experience in the different interaction with the different ministries, organization, and governmental agency. The citizen won't have anymore to have to deal with multiple systems, multiple application, multiple, identification practices or requirement for several documents or things like that. It will actually be for the citizen coming and be able, with the touch of a button on an app, for example, to identify itself and be actually recommended what are the next steps in his journey as a citizen in a country. So this is, for example, my remarks for today. And I hope I'll be speaking to with some of you in the future regarding this technology. Thank you.
Yeah. Thanks, Noah. I think it was very insightful to know about the graph system and how it can help the citizens and governments in the country. So I will now ask specific questions to our panelists. So I would request panelists to be short in their response in interest of time, because we have about 14 minutes left to close this conference. So my first question is for Mr. Amit Sharma. So, sir, there are multiple digital platforms available in private space like Amazon, Flipkart, Zomato, and citizens have experienced the level of services, the convenience that they get on using these services. So it's very intuitive, very easy. So when can we expect a similar level of efficiency from the government and public services? And what would the government need to do to achieve this level of services?
I think in my first introductory part of discussion, I talked about the same thing which we were actually thinking about. Already we are thinking in terms of same delivery at the doorstep of the last mile user. We're talking about a tie-up with CSE, SPV, India, through which we are actually going to involve them in a big way, like a public service guarantee. A lot of services are there. So we think that we can avail the advantage of them being already in the system. And like I told you that Khidmat centers, which were originally created for the deliverance of public services, could not touch the level of success like Vahini or other kind of models have worked, like Mi Seva in Andhra and similar kind of models we have done, Bangalore one. So those kinds of services. So I think that we need to revamp this CSE 2.0, and we have to actually get integrated with them to take services to the doorstep of the citizen. And when it comes to actually saving time, already in my first part of discussion, again, the same thing comes. E-office, if gets implemented in a proper manner, and it is actually getting implemented, I'm very happy to say that we are already in a paperless mode. My colleague sitting here would definitely, all seniors would say, like it is now many days that we actually write on paper with pen and all those things. Actually, we are doing drafting also online, everything online. And we are now more focused on getting good systems in place, good hardwares, good softwares, you see, with all those kinds of things. Because there's a paradigm shift, 360 degree turnaround, I would say, in the way we were delivering things in the past. Like in the evening also, sometime late night also, we are clearing the files. It was a distant dream, say 1 year back, same time. We could not even imagine. So I mean to say J&K has already taken a big leap. So far as reaching out to public is concerned, because files are moving, statuses are moving, dashboards are coming up big way. We are coming up with LG dashboard soon, in which Honorable LG can see every single department's performance, like where it is, where files are lying, everything at the click of a button. I mean to say, we are going a big way. A lot of things have been disseminated, already shared by other co-panelists, like J&K is going a big way out, like Atha talked about, Srinagar Municipal Corporation. Similarly, Jammu Municipal Corporation is going big way. I was seeing Avani Madam also, but she is not there. So I mean to say, we are doing a lot of projects in collaboration. My Jakega is doing, as CEO Jakega, I'm talking now, is doing a lot of collaborative projects. And I think, Athar, you are also in touch with us. So that way, we are going into the public, for the public, and helping out one way or the other. The best models were discussed by Commissioner SMC, and even Shafkat ji threw a lot of light on how we have reached out to the public in the health sector. This is equally important than education sector. Already, ma'am told, we are going a big way out, like ICT interventions and labor employment. Everywhere you will see us reaching out to public. And I'm sure next year, Vishal, when you come into such kind of conference with us, you would be very happily talking about, gladly talking about the way things have happened in this last month.
Sir, in fact, I would want the UT of J&K to be the torchbearer for the country in terms of implementation. The kind of passion I'm seeing in the people here, so I have no doubt in my mind that it will be the torchbearer for implementation of digital services for the country.
Yeah, support. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. So ma'am, to Madam Sarita Chauhan. Ma'am, you talked about the Shram Suvidha Portal, the new four labor codes and the eShram Portal. Ma'am, so can you also emphasize on the importance of eShram Portal for the labor force of the country, the unorganized sector, because they are the one who are marginalized and have faced the brunt of the pandemic. So what benefits they can see from this eShram Portal, ma'am?
Yeah, sure. The eShram portal, of course, it is developed by the Ministry of Labour and Employment and in collaboration with the Métis, with the NIC and the services being provided through the Common Service Center. The one big thing that will be achieved is first a database of all the unorganized workers. Once the database is available, there will be a single unique account number that will be universal account number, which will be available to every worker, whether most in the unorganized sector. And there are several, the verification is done through, of course, the Aadhaar-based, the Aadhaar card that they have, the Aadhaar number. Besides that, the moment they get themselves registered, you know, they are eligible to be covered under the Pradhan Mantri Bima Yojana, which means that they get the cover of the accidental benefit, which is up to 2 lakhs. There are different ranges for different benefits. So this is the first which they automatically get covered. Besides that, once you have a number of people, of the nature of people, the kind of work they're involved in, the kind of occupations they're involved in, the government can then come out with a with several social security schemes for them. And that is the objective. That is the objective, to provide the social security schemes and other benefits that can be provided to the workers depending on the occupations that they are in. So this is to begin with. As I said, last year when there was no definite data on the number of migrant workers, we saw that there was no way the governments or organizations could reach out to them, and things happened, you know, by physically reaching out to them. So the eShram portal is the beginning, as I said, by preparing a national database, and the declarations has to be made by the worker himself or herself on the on occupation, on family, etc. There is a very a minimalistic kind of, you know, of form which they have to fill up. It is free of cost. The registration is to be done free of cost. So that is about eShram, since that you asked me. But continuing with the another issue of employment, which is most important and at the center of, you know, every discussion that you can have at the national level. So employment also, we have developed a portal on the lines of the National Career Service, which is the central government's portal. And on this, we have this provision for both the job seeker and the job employer, provider to register themselves, and then they can see the skill set that are available for employment. Unemployed can register themselves, and then through this we are also going towards the skilling of those deficient skill sets, so as to make them ready for the employment market.
Thank you so much, ma'am. So Mr. Athar Khan, I have the next question for you. So in case there is a Smart Cities 2.0, what changes would you like to see? So based on the implementation of experience of Smart Cities mission in the city of Srinagar. So of course, there has some challenges, but what would you like to see different in Smart Cities 2.0? You're on mute, sir.
I think we are still in that implementation phase, so probably we have not yet reached to the stage where we can say now in the next phase this is how what should be done. I think there are a couple of things which I believe. One of the things which I think all the panelists have been discussing is the integration. That's something which we have been trying to look at carefully, and going forward that should be again a key, because services are being offered by n number of departments. Everyone is offering these services. They become useful to people only if they are available to citizens, you know, without putting an extra effort going here and there. Yes, of course, the common service center, as Amit sir was talking about, similarly now mobile phone is the way forward. That's the major way in which service delivery happens. So we have to ensure that at one place citizens can avail every service. That is one of the major endeavors that we are trying to do in terms of smart city, whether it is service of municipal corporation, whether it's a scholarship, whether it's an electricity connection, whether you have to pay your electricity bills, you have to pay water bills, whether you need to say avail some social security scheme, that should be available at one place, at one. So just like Amazon does, so all the vendors are at one place. That's something, look, going forward we want to do that. And again, many a times we do not I really liked when you were raising this point about how convenient and how easy using Amazon or Flipkart has become. So the similar kind of service delivery is also expected from public from departments. So we invest in background, we invest in our processing systems, our back-end systems, but many a times our front-end systems are not that good. So that is one thing which we are trying to look at, and it's going to be an iterative process. So one particular application, will have an issues, and over the period of time we have to build on that and come up to that optimal and the best solution possible forward. Number one. Number two, many of these exercises that we are doing, the quantum of these exercises is quite huge. For example, this GIS mapping which we are trying to do in Srinagar city, we have to cover around 1.8 lakh to 2 lakh properties or 2 lakh premises. And when we go on ground, speak to people, that again, that interaction, that surveying part becomes a challenge. So the back end, so these are some of the challenges. In fact, what we are trying to do is that we are actively also reaching out to people, trying to explain them what this GIS mapping is all about, what this service is all about, so that they are also on board. So I believe that going forward, number one, this integration has to be the key. And number second is the citizens, who are the actual stakeholders. They have to be a part and parcel of during the execution and also during the implementation phase. Otherwise, we just tell them at the time of when it is being launched. So that hand-holding and that communication has to happen actively, I believe, to make these things successful. Thank you.
Yeah. Can I make a point here at this point?
Sure, ma'am. Please come in.
Yeah. You know what Arthur or maybe Amit is trying to say is, look, there is a difference being government service provider and Amazon or such other private platforms. Here we have to ensure, as a matter of policy, as a matter of fairness, that we reach out to the last man in the queue, right? As compared to the other agencies that you mentioned, who have otherwise considerations it benefits to them that they reach out to the last mile, but of course the customers have to, you know, reach out to them in order to get the benefits. So the idea here is to create, while we move from paper to spreadsheets, etc., we have to see that we remain fair, that there is no discrimination, and each one has a good access to the to technology. And to that extent, BharatNet is being implemented, which means that the government is taking the fiber to the last village, and through villages now the PRIs, the public representative, the village panchayats, etc., and are also able to have services right there in their panchayats, and that we do not end up creating again another world of haves and have nots. So that is a big responsibility when it comes to government service delivery. Thank you.
Very valid point, ma'am. Inclusion has to be at the center of delivery of all public services, and digital divide, what we are seeing, I think BharatNet is trying to bridge that. So hopefully, I think in assisted mode, all would be able to access the services which government is trying to bring to the doorstep of people. So moving on the same, I think as Athar sir has said, that all services being available on one place. So the next question is to Dr. Shafkat Khan. So can the citizens of J&K expect, or the country expect, all health services being available on a single app or a platform? So whatever health services they need, public health services being available on a single app.
You see, Vishal, one thing I want to inform you, which not many people see across the country, is that J&K is a very robust healthcare system, which is, you know, totally government owned. And we have a very small private sector across the, across J&K. And if you look at the indicators, it's a success story. We have had a 10-digit fall in 18-19 of the infant mortality rate. We are at 16 right now. And that is the 10 best in the country, one of the 10 best. We have the best, indicators in the maternal. We are not, completely done it, but we are doing very good as compared to, most of the other states and union territories. And TFR is very low, the total fertility rate. So seeing, the life expectancy is also going very high. So our indicators show us that the government sector has done quite commendable in delivery of healthcare across J&K, in the previous years. Now, if I was asked what was, what were the loopholes, I would say the infrastructural, there's, that lopsided infrastructural development, which was, not based on any circumstantial, need. Like if you look at the primary health centers, sub-centers, they are plenty in number, but they are scattered in such a manner that there is no rationale of a smaller village having a sub-center or a primary health center in a larger village not having one. Places where there is a huge building in place, there is no human resource. So, the government had to, look at it, straight into the eye and take it as a huge challenge. When we saw that the human resource requirements and the infrastructure available was very, different. And then the rationalization of human resource into these health, institutions. Now, we are, looking at medical education as well. We have now 5 new medical colleges and 2 more are also being started. Maybe next year, the foundation is going to be laid. So the medical education will give a big leap in terms of our doctor-patient ratio and the nurse-patient ratio. That is a very important indicator in health services also always. When you have enough number of doctors for enough number of people. So another aspect we are catching up now is the public health finance management systems. So we have roped in WHO in this and one consultancy along with WHO, which we are looking into our the financial health of our systems. How funding is going into our healthcare system, how the funding is spent, is it audited properly? Is the flow of funding, going as per its speed and its momentum? And is the fund being spent in time? Why are funds lapsing in the healthcare system? Is the incentivization of health schemes taking place? Like the Janani Suraksha Yojana, the Janani Shishu Suraksha Yojana, JSSK, we have to provide free healthcare in hospital settings to mother and child. The antenatal, prenatal, postnatal checkups, they have to be organized in such a way that it is seamless right from the ASHA worker to the doctor and to the institutional deliveries. It has to be a seamless delivery, which has to be, helped and facilitated by the healthcare staff through the health department, through the National Health Mission staff. And for this, as I already told you, the digital part, which was earlier missing, has been, it's a very difficult terrain. We have various areas which are cut off in winters. But then our ASHA workers have been going from each corner of this UT, right into the hills, where there is 10, 15 kilometers of walking, the last point from where an automobile takes you. You have to walk 10, 15, 20 kilometers on foot. But still these...
I'm sorry to interrupt you, sir. Sir, we are running out of time. We have short 5 minutes past.
Okay, May. Vishal.
I request you to conclude your...
So I conclude with, the UT of JNK, I know, is taking a leap into the IT initiatives in the healthcare system. I know Amitji, our IT secretary, is a very robust, very dynamic man in the seat right now, and he will push us and the entire system into a very, very wonderful phase of prosperity and happiness, because I believe that all systems should lead to a happy system. You know, when you say smart cities have to make you happy. You know, it should be a happy city, so it's a smart city. So I think the man in charge can take us to that level of happiness, I'm sure.
Right. Thank you so much, Dr. Khan. So in fact, we have overshot time. I would like to now conclude.
We can take last 2 minutes from Noah and we'll end then. Ending remarks by Noah.
Yeah, well, thank you very much, everybody, for those contributions. That was very interesting, and to learn about all those initiatives that are being currently undertaken and have been actually done also from the different governmental agencies and different municipalities and people. And Hello. This is, so I would like for the last few minutes, just, whoop, we have someone who's unmute.
Hello.
Yeah.
Requesting Shafkat sir to please mute his mic. Shafkat sir, if you can mute your mic, please.
Thank you. So I just wanted to take the last minute to just thank everybody for being there and for their contribution. That was very, very informative. Thank you very much again. And I am personally looking forward to potentially working with you in the future to bring all these interesting technologies and initiatives to the next level. Thank you very much.
Vishal, you there? So till the time Vishal joins back, so I'd like to thank you all, and I would request my backend team to present a small certificate, e-certificates to all of you. So I would like to start with Mr. Amit Sharmaji. Backend team, if you can just put on the certificate.
We are the host here. I don't require it, but anyways, thanks a lot.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Then I'd
thank
like you. To present the certificate to Sarita ma'am. Sarita ma'am, thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.
Also. At a very short notice, ma'am agreed to come. So gratitude. Yes.
My pleasure. Amit, my pleasure. Thank you.
Then Mr. Athar, sir, if you can move. Thank you, Athar, sir. We'll be sending this over an email to all of you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Athar, for coming.
Shafkat Khan, sir. Thank you, Shafkat, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Fahim. Thanks a lot. Thanks. It means a lot to
thank
me.
Thank you, Athar. Thanks.
Noah, the next speaker. Thanks, Noah.
Thank you very much. This is appreciated. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Noah. Thanks for coming.
And Vishal. Vishal has been missed, like his network. There was some issue. He has disconnected. So Vishal has thank you all on his behalf. And we look forward to having you all in our next conclave. That's on 26th of November. We'll be doing a smart cities conclave, as I mentioned, where the smart city, Srinagar Smart City Limited will be the host partner and Athar sir will be the program mentor for that. Welcome. We'd like to see you all. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot. Thank you very much.
Thank you, everyone. Thanks, everyone.